experience all these engineering difficulties and how we're all carrying tools to just get a presentation going. You know, my apologies too, if this is a little bit small, I'll try to walk you through each slide. But today I'm going to be talking about new delivery platforms for the prevention of oral and vaginal infections. And so the focus of our laboratory has been to create new delivery vehicles that enhance the delivery of everything from drugs to genes, proteins, peptides, against different pathologies, including viral, sexually transmitted infections, cancer, and bacterial biofilms. And so I provide these SEM images as examples of nanoparticles and electrospun fibers, the macromorphologies of these that we study in our lab. So some of the primary project foci that we look into are, we develop different materials for female reproductive tract viral infections. We've done some work looking at similar fibers and nanoparticles to combat oral bacterial biofilms. That enabled us to expand some of our drug delivery work to combat bacterial infections in the female reproductive tract. And we've also done some work on reproductive and ocular cancers, but I'm going to focus, you know, due to the amount of time we have today, on the first three projects that we have going in our lab. So first I'll talk to you about developing different delivery vehicles to prevent viral STIs, utilizing nanoparticles and fibers to target oral bacterial infections, and designing biomaterials to target bacterial reproductive infections. So one of the things we may all be aware of is that global health challenges exist, and that if we look at herpes simplex virus type 2 and HIV 1 alone, they affect a large number of people globally. It's a pandemic, with over 500 million people affected by HSV2 and about 37 million affected by HIV1. And this often spans even more prominently in developing countries. One of the reasons that we care about developing materials to inhibit both HSV and HIV infections is that herpes simplex virus 2, while not a lethal infection, is a major cofactor in facilitating HIV infection and transmission. And it impacts immune cell recruitment, inflammation, and localization. And so what this means is if somebody has herpes simplex virus 2 or HSV2, and they have intermittent flare-ups or lesions, there's previously unmeasurable viral loads present even as much as 3 months, 6 months after the infection, in which the inflammation stimulated from these viral infections recruits immune cells to the area, which are then much more likely, from about 4 to 7-fold more likely to be infected with HIV1. So we're really interested in developing both current strategies against HIV1 and HSV2. For HIV, which poses perhaps more challenges to global health, there's of course antiretrovirals, or ARVs, that they exist to target HIV at different points in the life cycle. However, they don't cure HIV, and they're really, they can be toxic, induce virus resistance, and there's this issue of people wanting to use or using these every day to prevent virus infection. There's vaccines, but effective vaccines are not yet available. One reason is due to the high mutation rate of HIV and really gathering a further understanding of the immune system. So one area that we've worked on in the past number of years is developing microbicides, which can be defined as any chemical that reduces and prevents the transmission of STIs. So microbicides provide promising alternatives relative to these others to prevent and treat virus infections. Some of the factors we have to think about, and I come at this from an engineering perspective, is how can we design microbicides for delivery to the female reproductive tract? And some things you want to think about when you're developing a product is that it's easy, convenient to use, potentially inexpensive, discreet, and female control to administer when needed. Perhaps something that offers both preventative and therapeutic features. And I've just highlighted on this cross-section of the female reproductive tract, showing the mucosa here, where we have our superficial layer of mucus, which is shed about every 4 to 24 hours, the epithelium in the middle layer, which is where the cells reside to be infected by HSV2, and then the underlying lamina propria, where a lot of the immune cells reside and which you can get infected with HIV1. And there's been a number of different active agents to bind to incoming virus ways, or to disrupt or debilitate virus in terms of those antiretroviral drugs I described. But one of our ideas is that we'd like to create or integrate benefits to create a specifically targeted microbicide. Now you have all these active agents, but in the harsh environment, it's typically about an acidic pH of about 4.5 2 to 4.5. You need delivery vehicles to deliver these active agents and keep them present to reduce both viral and bacterial infections. And so some of the prominent ones are gels, but gels really offer only transient delivery and they often leak out, contributing to low user adherence of these platforms. Films, similarly, they have low user adherence and often only offer transient treatments and might need to be applied every day. The gold standard to date has been intravaginal rings, which remarkably provide up to 90 days sustained release of everything from contraceptives to different antiviral agents. And then also nanoparticles were a front runner in terms of developing delivery vehicles that could readily distribute throughout the female reproductive tract. And however, they have issues still where nanoparticles are prone to leak into the vaginal cavity. So you might wonder, you know, why do we want to incorporate active agents in different polymeric nanomaterials, and it offers localized or topical delivery, high encapsulation of agents to increase the localized concentration. Again, it can enhance agent stability in the harsh or oral microenvironments. You can actually tune these systems to offer sustained relief. So one of the biggest things with microbicide trials to date is that they'll give, for instance, women a platform to utilize, perhaps intravaginal gels. They have to apply that every 24 hours, but either women don't really have a user preference toward that, or they leak out, making them ineffective. So even if somebody were to be prescribed that, they really only offer modest efficacy, in some cases as low as in the 30% to be efficacious against virus prevention. So another thing is that we can choose different materials to tune these release properties of active agents from materials. Can surface modify carriers if you want them to be taken up or internalized in only specific cell types or tissue or by viruses. And then you can also develop complementary delivery systems, which I'll talk to you about a little bit today, and how we've developed nanoparticles and fibers to inhibit virus infections. Within the field of microbicide delivery against STIs, again, we really want novel alternative vehicles that can enhance user adherence, keep people either using those every day, or just decrease the frequency of administration so you can administer them once every month, once every week. We also want to avert an over-reliance, so on the antiretroviral agents I was mentioning to you, because they can cause viral resistance and toxicity, we want to avert that. We want something that provides long and sustainable delivery of about a week to a month, or maybe even stimuli-responsive on-demand delivery. Something that is dual purpose, which I'll talk to you about today, or maybe even multi-purpose against multiple infection types, maybe offering protection against infections and a contraceptive in one. Again, enable specific targeting if you're able to. And then this idea of co-delivering biologics, which haven't been used so much for intravaginal delivery, and antiviral drugs to employ different mechanisms of action against different virus infection stages. And so one way, prior to coming to UofL, that we had addressed this is I had looked at a nanoparticle platform with these comprised of polylactic cholinolactic acid, or PLGA nanoparticles. And in these, we can encapsulate different active agents like siRNA, you know, drugs, proteins. You can co-encapsulate agents. You can surface modify these with stealth characteristics, you know, to penetrate mucus to underlying cells or to conversely enable them to be retained by bioadhesion. We have antibodies for targeting, and then we have what are called cell-penetrating peptides, or facilitators of uptake or transport, which is really important if you're delivering drugs and your, I should say, genes, and you need to get them into cells. And so some of our early work in this area looked at how can we inhibit host epithelial cells from being infected with HSV2 up on the top left. And in our previous work, we had developed nanoparticles that delivered small interfering RNA to basically knock down these host cell receptors and inhibit a pathway through which HSV2 would enter. And we actually found that we could inhibit high numbers of animals in a murine model from becoming infected. But when I came to UofL, you know, one thought we had is that for nanoparticle design, people are constantly designing around the whole issue of mucus. So the mucus and mucins within mucus, often they do a great job at binding to viruses that come in. In fact, that's why we attribute very low rates of infection, you know, like 0.2 or 0.02% for HIV infection. It's because the virus is debilitated or trapped by the mucus and does not reach these underlying cells to infect. But the idea is, you know, for nanoparticles, just like anything else, you have to design around this and actually get your activation well. So mucus is also a transport barrier to delivery vehicles. So one thing I started thinking about upon coming to you, Phil, is how might we design a better material that almost acts like mucus to protect against viral infection? And so one of the inspirations, you know, kind of looking at how viruses transport into cells, is one of the first steps, and I know it can be a little hard to see here, but we have herpes simplex virus that kind of comes and binds to the cell filipodia and really does that non-specifically through, you know, through these non-specific interactions with the filipodia in adhesive interactions, and then it does what is called surfs down that filipodia to the cell surface where it either fuses or is endocytosed into the cell and infects. Now, one idea might be if we could adhere to it, similarly to how mucus adheres to viruses, even not specifically, we might be able to stop virus from infecting cells. And so looking at how we can develop materials as a mucus barrier. And then here is a video that I always enjoy showing, you know, since my expertise is more in engineering from a biology perspective, just to look at how these virions, here HSV2, transport on these filipodia to the cell surface and subsequently infect, and the viruses are in green and red respectively. And this work was done by a group at UIC. So when I came here, one of the thoughts I had is, might we be able to develop what is called a stationary platform? So mobile particles are kind of mobile, can be distributed all over, provide actually very, very well coverage of the female reproductive tract. But might we be able to combine this with a stationary platform, something like electrospun fibers that have a morphology like a mucus mesh, and might be able to depilinate virus, and at the same time you can incorporate active agents within the fibers to inhibit virus infection. Maybe we could even surface modify these fibers to provide an additional adhesive virus strap, and then combine those with a mobile platform like nanoparticles was kind of the 5 or 6 year goal here. And so looking at, we had a collaborator that actually wanted to work with us on developing, they make fibers, we make nanoparticles, wanted to make a product for diabetes applications. And so I started thinking about how might we develop these fibers for intravaginal applications. And so to introduce you guys as engineers to this, we have an electrospinning principle where, you know, conceptually it should be a fairly straightforward, easy process. You put polymer and a solvent in a syringe here, apply an electric field, and you collect what ends up being like things like paper or a plastic bag on a rotating and grounded mandrel. Well, there are a lot of parameters to optimize, but we have done that in the last number of years and created constructs of these are like in a 6 millimeter petri dish, have created different constructs of these fibers. From an engineering perspective, you know, I say conceptually it should be easy, but for each polymer type we actually make, there's a lot of formulations we need to go through, even if they're well defined in literature, where you have things like increasing or decreasing the flow rate, could cause you to have things that are less fiber structured, more particle structured. Increasing your solution or solvent concentration will result in better, more well-formed fibers, and so on. So there's a number of parameters to optimize fibers. So we kick things off looking at PLGA fibers and also polycaprolactone or polyl-caprolactone fibers here, because both were FDA approved. We know they're safe, and it's really important for intravaginal applications because if you're administering something that causes inflammation in an area where that can promote further virus infection, you want to minimize that. So here I show just SEM images on the left of the micro or nano structure of these fibers and what they looked like upon our design for insertion into a mouse reproductive model. And I'm just gonna show you some of the highlights of this work, and that one of the first drugs, we wanted to get our bearings with drugs first. They're less readily degraded by solvents and such. So we incorporated acyclovir, tested this first against HSV2. We showed that relative to free acyclovir, you know, our fibers, the acyclovir did not lose activity, had about the same inhibition activity as free acyclovir, but that only worked against HSV2. And then we started looking at the drug tenofovir disoproxil fumarate, which is actually one component of the prevention drug, the PrEP drug that's on the market, Truvada, but alone it's called Viriad. And we looked at how can TDF inhibit both HSV2 and HIV-1 and provide dual purpose protection against infections. And so in vitro, we were able to show that it fully, these fibers of TDF fully inhibited HIV-1 and they fully inhibited HSV-2, albeit at a higher dose due to the drug's potency. Well, we had noticed diminished levels of infection for both HIV and HSV2 just with blank fibers alone. So what we ended up looking at is we designed an assay where we have these transwell plates. And on the left, we have, so we have a transwell plate where you could either stick fibers or not. And in the bottom, you have cells that could be infected. So here we have no, you know, we didn't infect, we don't have any fibers, so you don't expect anything to happen. Here, we don't have a fiber sitting here, so any virus we put on this transwell plate, we expect to go through. So it's going to result in infected cells, as shown in the bottom here with these little virions. But what we hypothesized would happen based on some of our other assays is that wells in which you had a fiber in there, but also added virus infection, that some of those viruses may get through, but not significantly. So that basically blank fibers could act as physical inhibition to virus infection. And so looking at this in terms of a plaque assay, for those of you that are interested, in purple, we have all the live cells, so cells that have not been infected. Anything that's clear means the cells are dead from HSV2 infection. And so here we show, you know, no treatment again on the left. Those infected with HSV2, where we have that on the right, we have PLGA fibers and PLCL fibers in the latter two columns. And what we show is that up to 48 hours, what's really exciting is for these last two columns, we get full inhibition of virus without even adding any drug. So at 72 hours, they start to allow, and this is fibers soaking in media for 48 to 72 hours, they start to allow viruses to penetrate to underlying cells and infect them. But at least we can add a claim here that for short durations, and really for interventional delivery, this isn't even short, for short durations, if your fiber comes in contact with the virus, you have the ability to somewhat provide a physical barrier on top of the chemical barrier already provided to inhibit infection. But we wanted to take this a step further and think about how might we use these concepts that the virus naturally uses both to adhere to the cell and mucus uses to protect the body from infection with the cell, use these, design something that might be bio-inspired and somewhat adhesive to add additional potency to our constructs. And so at the time I have a collaborator, Dr. Palmer, who is working on a molecule called Grafitzin. It's isolated from the red algae Grafitzia. It's a novel anti-HIV lectin protein. It is ubiquitously works against many viruses, everything from Ebola, hepatitis, HPV, HIV, HSV2, and really the list goes on. So it's a very powerful and potent lectin. In terms of HIV, it binds to the envelope glycoprotein GP120, and through that mechanism, not only does it bind or adhere to virus, but it inactivates the virus. Simultaneously, it also helps, while I don't show here, against HSV2 infection by inhibiting the cell-to-cell spread of HSV2. But we need to make sure, tested this with our antiviral agents, biologics are a little more challenging to electrospin and incorporate with different solvents, so that's why we tested first with typical antiviral drugs. So we've made a number of different platforms, you know, nanoparticles that encapsulate and are surface modified with this Grafitzin that's also it's really sticky. But I'll just show you some of the data on our nanofibers that are surface modified with Grafitzin. And so one idea we had was that you could put this very sticky adhesive lectin on the surface of fibers, on all of those little micron-sized fibers, and that they would bind to virus and be able to inactivate it. And so you might also at the same time incorporate something within the fiber, like those other active agents, to release slowly over time and have complementary routes of protection. And so what we showed here was that in untreated, on the x-axis we show the different treatment groups, either untreated or fibers modified with different amounts of Grafitzin on the surface. And we did about an 8 to 10 dose virus reduction here, where we tested for each set of histograms here against different doses of HIV. And then on the y-axis, we have the amount of HIV infection relative to untreated infected cells. And so what we show is that we see this dose response for untreated, as we should, because the cells haven't been treated, and you're just varying the dose of virus. But when we start to add different amounts, increasing the amount of Grafitzin in our fibers, these Grafitzin virus trap fibers alone can completely protect in vitro against HIV infection. We've also expanded to consider things like pH responsive Grafitzin fibers. So one of the areas that is interesting, particularly if you're developing something that, you know, you're trying to deliver something that's expensive or maybe hard to produce, like a protein or gene would be, is how can you minimize release when that's just sitting in the reproductive cavity or in any microenvironment? So you spend all this money to isolate the protein and to develop it. You don't want 80% of it to come out in a burst release fraction, which is typical with a lot of polymeric materials. So we designed pH responsive GRFS and fibers, where it would only release GRFSN when the pH was raised from about 4.2 to 4.5 to when semen infiltrates closer to a pH of 7. And so I'm just showing you key release results. Well, here I'm showing cumulative GRFSN release on the y-axis versus time. And so just taking, for example, what we would do here is we'd have our pH responsive fiber sitting in simulated vaginal fluid for 24, 48, or 72 hours. And at that time, we would either switch to PBS here, which is neutrally charged, or here a more representative mixture of semen mixed with simulated vaginal fluid. And very excitingly to us, you know, this is kind of the last graph of formulation optimization, this formulation completely inhibits GRFSN from coming out unless you're exposed to something within the pH range of semen. So we have that, and we're trying to keep this short. These also demonstrated potent efficacy as well in vitro against HIV and HSV2 infections. But one of our long-term goals, you know, as stated in that earlier slide, was is there a way that we can combine the complementary features of electrospun fibers with nanoparticles to almost provide different modes of protection? So I mentioned that issue of nanoparticles readily leaking out of the vaginal cavity. As much as they may leak out with the shedding of mucus or just due to them being in a gel-like solution, they do have an attribute in that they can penetrate underlying cells where, in particular, like HIV and HSV2 infections occur. So they have a mobility that's not always offered with, like, say, a piece of paper or a fiber you're inserting intravaginally. So I wanted to look at how we can merge these forms together to either complement delivery or maybe sustain delivery of active agents from our platforms. And so we started, of course, you know, just start with one platform, and we wanted to make GRFSN nanoparticles here, where I'm showing the amount of GRFSN release on the y-axis as a function of time. And if we're developing something that we want to release for 1 week to 1 month, we can tell that the release profiles from these particles, you know, they're marginal within the first 72 hours, but pretty poor after that. So we started thinking, how can we make a nanoparticle fiber composite, and I'll just show you an example of one of these, where you might, for example, electrospin fibers, a hydrophobic layer, and then electrospin a hydrophilic layer that contains these nanoparticles, and encase them in a more advanced architecture to modulate release of active agents for out to a month or longer to rival intravaginal rings. And so using these sequentially spun fibers as an example, so here's an example, we put little fluorescently labeled nanoparticles in the electrospun fiber, and we can detect them under fluorescent microscopy and SEM. Again, in panel A here, it's a step where I'm putting these nanoparticles in a hydrophilic layer, which alone, that would be just considered like a rapid release fiber film that you can put in and protect yourself. But if incorporated in this multi-layered construct, we hypothesized that modulating that outer layer thickness and even using this architecture altogether could tune release. And so indeed, what we saw was some dependence upon the outer shell thickness, or it correlates to the volume of what you're electrospinning, and that those with the thinnest outer layer release the greatest amount of GRFSN, whereas those coated with more substantial layers of a hydrophobic polymer slow release. But regardless of that, what was really exciting to us, and I don't have the most recent curve here, is we demonstrate sustained delivery that rivals intravaginal rings out to about 90 days using this technique. So it's very exciting to us. These worked both in vitro and in vivo against both types of infection. And so kind of bringing all of these viral studies together, we wanted to, of course, look at the in vivo efficacy of these fibers in a murine model, a lethal model of infection, where you infect mice with HSV2, and after some time, after 14 days, you look at how the virus is progressing with respect to time. And so here, tested a rapid release fiber, so those that dissolve really readily, infected mice with HSV2. We had administered these fibers about 24 hours prior, and what we show is that rapid release fibers alone, at least for the initial time frame we tested in these preliminary studies, both the hydrophilic and E. coli layer was able to to inhibit infection similarly to free gefitzin. Interestingly, correlating these length fiber results and their ability to inhibit infection, we saw about 50% inhibition just by putting in rapid release fibers with nothing in them. And then when we can compare it to our positive control for infection, our N9 gel, which stimulates inflammation, thereby making the animals more susceptible to infection, and untreated infected animals all had passed by day 14. The platform we were really interested in was looking at the sustained release fibers. Those are basically putting the rapid release fiber in that outer concentric layer of hydrophobic fiber. And what we saw again was that our gefitzin nanoparticle fiber construct that combined the platform provided similar efficacy for the time frames we tested against HSV2 infection, with nanoparticles coming in slightly below in terms of efficacy. These multi-layered composites protected animals alone, if they were just blank without gefitzin, about 40% against infection, and then our N9 gel in untreated infected animals were almost fully infected at the doses we tested out to 14 days. In addition, I want to point out that for all of our treatment groups, whether that's gefitzin or gefitzin nanoparticles and fibers, they all, in addition to lowering levels of infection and increasing survival, they slowed the overall progression of infection as a function of, we score the mice based on pathological symptoms relative to untreated infected in those mice that received gel. And then last, we wanted to look at how safe these are, and we did both histology and cytokine studies to assess that. And for this part, I'll leave this at both our blank, all of the blank fibers, blank sustained delivery platforms, they induced no inflammation, at least from a macro histology perspective, similar to untreated. Whereas our sham control, just simply using, tweezers or an N9 gel, elicited, maybe 1 in 3 animals saw some sort of tissue disruption. And we also looked at cytokine expression. So cytokines can induce at a finer level what sorts of inflammation or biochemical cascades are occurring after administration of either rapid release fibers on the top, sustained release on the bottom. And typically in intravaginal delivery, you're looking at a 2- to 5-fold expression relative to untreated tissue is considered acceptable. And overall, we achieved that within a 2- to 5-fold range. There were a couple cytokines that were expressed at about a 5-fold level, but also expressed in just sham-treated mice. So some of this, we think, is in part due to administration method. At least we do not have multiple cytokines expressed in parallel, which would lead us to believe there was an inflammatory response. So these results combined demonstrate that the fibers are effective against HSV2 in vivo and are safe. So here we show you a variety of delivery vehicles demonstrate dual-purpose activity against HSV2 and HIV infections. We created these sustained-release fibers with the capacity to rival intravaginal rings from a duration perspective. Our architectures prevent HSV infection in vivo and demonstrate strong preliminary safety in vivo. So these, as I mentioned, were preliminary animal studies. We're looking to build on these, and some things that we need to look at are evaluating the dose dependence of our nanoparticle fiber composites, and also looking at multiple challenge times with respect to infection. So that's really important for a sustained delivery platform. If you're hoping it works a month after you put it in, you need to challenge with the virus 1 month after inserting these fibers. So we look forward to expanding that, and then also exploring, it's believed that gefitzin, due to its lectin binding properties, may also inhibit sperm motility, so we're looking at exploring these as potential contraceptives as well. So with all of this work in parallel at the same time upon coming to UofL, I had the pleasure of learning a little bit more about oral microbial infections and how we could develop delivery platforms to combat those, and this work was in collaboration with Dr. Don DeMuth in the dental school. So I'll introduce you to one of the primary pathologies in terms of oral disease, is periodontal disease, and periodontitis is a chronic inflammatory disease that affects tissue that surround and support teeth, and that leads to bone loss. Microbial biofilms are really the major concerns for systemic infectious diseases. I'm sure you guys have seen studies looking at things like everything from like Alzheimer's to heart disease, and that's oftentimes for some of these more planktonic communities being released from biofilms and setting up shop in another area of the body via the systemic system. So plaque is an oral biofilm, so what we think of of this plaque on our teeth. It's a biofilm that adheres to the teeth, consists of many species of both fungal and bacterial cells. And when you get accumulation of this, it can result in the early stages in gingivitis, but eventually periodontitis. And so there's approximately 200-250 species that account for 90% of the biomass. And you really have these distinct communities that exist in like these gingival environments. Biofilms are very structured and highly organized communities. So, you know, we don't normally go around thinking about the biofilms in our mouth, but how we can just ask ourselves, how do our dentists currently deal with the plaque that we have when we come in for perhaps our teeth cleaning? And so they remove the biofilm or plaque through what's a process called mechanical debridement, or more easily to us, cleaning, in efforts to repair or restore the damage. And so I hope we all don't think I'm a horror movie buff, but I like to keep these mutually exclusive, the dentist and my love of horror movies. So as much as we dislike all of us going to the dentist, right, that is the gold standard now, would be mechanical therapy, but not all patients respond uniformly. Moreover, the biofilms and plaque in our mouth, they just start rebuilding right after we leave the dentist's office. So some other options are to use systemic and local antibiotic delivery, but you know, you can get bacterial recolonization, you can get antibiotic resistance, emergence of other fungal opportunistic infections. So we're really looking for new biologic approaches that might enable more specific targeting of these species involved in oral biofilm formation. But to date, there is not many specific targets that have been developed as activations. So yeah, I can probably breeze through these slides, but I just wanted to mention two species. And for the engineering crowd, I understand it might be a bit detailed, but we have two species that are among key pathogens that facilitate this biofilm growth and the subsequent, you know, gingivitis and eventually periodontitis that stem from that. So we have, I'll keep it, Streptococcus boredoni. It has a high affinity for proteins in the saliva. It's a benign organism, which is really interesting in the oral environment, so a commensal bacteria. But it functions as an attachment substrate for late colonizers, meaning that any pathogenic bacteria can come in and have a propensity of adhering to S. boredoni and facilitating infection. So it's a great example of how commensal bacteria can promote, you know, some of these deleterious pathways in you know, oral health. So one thing they do know is that there's something called SSPV, and it's a surface protein on this bacteria, and a region of that SSPV, designated BR, interacts with a protein that's on this other bacteria called P. gingivalis, which is actually more of a pathogenic bacteria that comes in and wants to adhere to SG on your teeth and on your gums. So here's P. gingivalis. It's noted for being one of these key or keystone pathogens that is responsible when it binds to SG for some of these deleterious pathways in oral health. It adheres, what's important for this presentation is that it adheres to S. boredoni through also a protein. These are always protein-protein interactions. Here it's called minor fibril protein A1, which interacts with that SSB RAR region on SG. So we have a synthetic peptide that our collaborators created to very specifically target two of these bacteria that are kind of the first builders of all of these biofilms. And so we'll just call that peptide BAR. And our collaborators had established that it inhibits PG adherence to S. boredoni. So they identified this region, amino acids 1167 to 1193. And they'd shown that by administering that peptide, it would disrupt this bond highlighted in yellow and induce effects where you wouldn't get P. gingivalis binding to S. boredoni, hence inhibiting the biofilm formation and subsequent pathology in the mouth. But what they came to us about is they said, you know, the relative potency of this peptide is relatively low. It's in the micromolar range. It's IC50 is about inhibitory concentration at which half the bacteria are inhibited is about 1.3 micromolars. So like, how might we be able to develop a drug delivery vehicle that can administer a higher concentration of BAR and maybe prolong these biofilms to higher exposure times? Moreover, if you have multi-species, right, we talk about these hundreds of species in the mouth, and if you look at things like 2 and 3 species biofilms, you need to ensure that you're delivering a high enough concentration to get in there and inhibit multi-species biofilms. So one of our initial ideas, and we've built a number of platforms for this group to use, is utilizing this peptide bar. You know, might nanoparticles be able to enhance the potency or duration of bar? Can they increase efficacy? Moreover, like if you were to, if there's prevention where you put it down before you get a biofilm, but breaking through these biofilms, your degree might be 650 class. We just had a lecture on how you can disrupt biofilms and that matrix associated with biofilm formation that's very difficult due to the exopolysaccharide to break through. So we designed these particles where we hypothesized by surface modifying them with different amounts of bar that we may be able to inhibit infection in the oral cavity at a lower dose than using free bar alone. And so one thing I want to emphasize here is when I describe to students this, so we have this concept of multivalency going on here, where if you look at a peptide, it's like you're falling off of a cliff and your finger is a peptide and you're trying to hold onto the cliff with one finger, you're going to have an inherent dissociation and association rates, right? So you'll lose contact and not be adhered to the cliff, and in our case, that's still be bad news for us all. But if instead you have a particle that's designed to mimic something like using all hands and on the peptide, there's hundreds of peptides on this particle surface, but to use, say, your five fingers on your hand to grip, and assuming you're really good with one arm to not fall off a cliff, that's right. You have those five fingers where even if a couple peptides or fingers slip off the cliff due to the inherent binding rate, use the concept of multivalency to still adhere to that cliff, even with that interaction. So the same concept applies, you know, in a more sophisticated mathematical framework, I guess, multivalent particles. And that's what we sought to do, was to design multivalent particles to lower the dose of bar peptide that we need to inhibit biofilms. So here I just want to show you, this is looking at in vitro biofilms under the microscope, and we have our control off to the left where we have S. gordoni adhered to the surface in red. We come in and we administer particles, or not, with PG, the pathogenic bacteria, so that's shown in green. And so typically you would get a surface covered completely in green if you have no inhibition, but that bacteria, that PG coming in and adhering to SG. And so what we show is, of course, a dose-dependent efficacy modulated by bar, where the IC50 is about 1.3 micromolar, where you need about 1.7 or above to fully inhibit that green PG bacteria from adhering. But if we use nanoparticles, we notice that the IC50 was about 0.2 micromolar, and so about a sevenfold gain in efficacy just from using multivalent particles. Now, from this experiment alone, we didn't know that. So we designed an experiment to ensure that our mechanism was in fact modulated by multivalency. And so here, and try to keep this picture in mind for the subsequent results I'll show you, we have different particles that have decreasing amounts of bar peptide on the surface going across, but we would administer the same amount, different amounts of particles to make the bar amount exactly equal. So you're only changing, you're like administering, you know, 10 of these and maybe one of these, all the same dose. The looking of multivalency contributes to inhibiting biofilm formation. And so, of course, in our controls, PBS alone or putting on a positively charged nanoparticle like Avin, we're still getting that green PG biofilm existing here. If we look here at decreasing nanoparticle dose, for a particular concentration, of course, you're going to have a dose dependence, whereas you get to lower and lower doses, you're going to start to see some biofilm formation. We just expect that from dose dependence. But the interesting thing is if we kept the amount of bar constant, but we had different amounts of bar on the surface of nanoparticles, you can see going left to right that as you administer the same exact amount of bar, but just less bar on the surface, making it less multivalent, I'll just breeze through here to show you again, that multivalency modulates the amount of infection. So we also looked, that was for inhibition, and we also did some experiments just to ensure that our particles relative to control, that the modified particles were able to disrupt pre-established biofilms. We also had other experiments where we encapsulated bar to provide sustained release, and as expected, because they don't have multivalency, they provided inhibition similar to our control. And then all against kind of our maximum concentration of free bar. So we were able to show here that both bar-modified and encapsulated particles inhibited biofilm infection. so our previous work, all of that demonstrates that we can potently inhibit infection in vitro at least. But we wanted to assess the effectiveness of both FreeBAR and our new BAR modified particles to inhibit PG infection in a murine model. So in this model, we add, you know, the commensal bacteria, so tendon line colony forming units of Escordoni into the murine oral cavity. We then added, we gave five different doses of the pathogenic bacteria at a lower dose, combined with BARMOD nanoparticles or FreeBAR every other day for 10 days, so five treatment doses. And what we wanted to assess is in a murine model, as what happens in humans, but it's more accelerated than the murine model, is to look at the amount of bone loss between that alveolar, what's called the alveolar bone crest, and the cemento-enamel junction. And so you extract these teeth, do histology, look under dissecting microscopes. And why this matters is because typically, as infection progresses, you have something like, if you have gingivalis, right, or gingivitis, you might have a 2 millimeter to 3 millimeter jump depth between that, I'll just call it ABC, and then the cement enamel junction. But as that progresses to periodontal disease and progresses then to bone loss, that can go as far as 12 millimeter bone loss. So we looked at this in animals after that duration of 45 additional days, and here we basically looked at all these under a dissecting microscope, compared to untreated uninfected mice, with mice that were infected with both bacteria. Those that were infected with their SG or PG only, you do not see any difference really in that bone loss because they need each other. So commensals and the pathogenic bacteria interact with each other to induce bone loss over time. And we looked at sub-inhibitory levels of BAR, which we hypothesized would have promote some levels of inflammation because you're not completely preventing biofilm formation relative to free BAR and BAR modified nanoparticle applications. And so what we saw was very exciting. We're looking at the amount of alveolar bone loss over about that 80-day treatment duration in mice. And we saw that BAR nanoparticle treated mice demonstrated similar bone loss, which was negligible relative to uninfected, untreated controls, and showed statistically significant differences relative to either free BAR treated or free BAR sub-inhibitory levels relative to the amount of bone loss, and in particular, of course, relative to our infected group of SG plus PG. So demonstrating the efficacy of these multivalent nanoparticles relative to other treatment modalities against PG infection. We also, and I'll just breeze through this, looked at gingival epithelium, cytokines, as we did in the last experiment, and saw, of course, for, you know, our control group, healthy tissue. We saw for SGPG complete obliteration of the epithelial layers and inflammation. For free BAR and BAR modified nanoparticles, they had no inflammation, no infiltration of leukocytes, similar to your control of untreated, whereas those treated with sub-inhibitory levels of BAR showed some moderate levels of inflammation. And although I'm not a pathologist that looked at this, showed also some blood vessel enlargement in these images as well. So from this, we know that modified BAR nanoparticles are safe and efficacious, particularly relative to free BAR and our control groups. So we have that BAR modified nanoparticles demonstrate enhanced inhibition and disruption relative to free BAR, and we attribute this to multivalent interactions with PG. We also showed in other studies BAR encapsulated particles can potently inhibit dual species biofilms. We believe the incorporation of BAR in or on these nanoparticles is therefore an effective delivery approach, as our in vivo data indicate that they might be a promising option to abrogate periodontitis initiated by these two very specific bacteria. And so some of the things that we're working to do, it's exciting. We're looking at the effectiveness against these, against more complex multi-species biofilms. We are also looking, there's a protein that has been shown called CAFE to be a novel adhesion target, and to target that to the oral tissues such that if you can retain these nanoparticles, so imagine if it's like a mouthwash and you're sticking this in your mouth, you'll swallow or lose them, but if we can make something that's more adhesive to retain particles in the oral cavity. And we also have some really exciting work where we've developed similar fibers to release BAR peptide as a new formula. You can be formulated to a gum or to a, like a Listerine breath strip, with the appropriate formulation chemists on our team. And so then we had developed this background. It was really exciting for me. My first years here, I had primarily a virus and cancer background before joining the team here at UofL. And then with the oral bacterial work, what was really exciting to me with my love for the female reproductive infections is that enables us to reach out and to study these bacterial infections in the female reproductive tract. And so we could, you know, that the vision is, can you develop a product that would work against not only viruses, but also the ubiquitous bacterial infections that plague so many women? And so using the knowledge and skills that we gained from that project with Dr. Tamud, we've recently started working on bacterial vaginosis. And this is a dysbiotic, you know, polymicrobial imbalance in the vaginal microbiota of women. It affects about 30% of women at any given time. And, you know, relatively young women between the ages of 14 to 49, that's in the U.S. alone, it can be worse. And you know, global rates are more challenging. It's associated, importantly, with infection, preterm birth, and other adverse health outcomes. What we do know is that in the normal vaginal microbiota, lactobacilli are still the primary microbial community that help maintain host homeostasis and provide defense against incoming pathogens. And how this does this is the lactobacilli, it's postulated that they are able to drive down that pH in the vaginal reproductive space to acidic pHs, of which some bacteria, these pathogenic bacteria, do not thrive well in those environments. And they do this by emitting lactic acid, things like hydrogen peroxide, to further that environment and make it inhospitable to pathogenic bacteria. But in the vaginal microbiota, of course, there are these pathogenic microbes. One is Gardnerella vaginalis, and it's one of the most frequently isolated pathogen species contributing to BV. It alters this ecology in the female reproductive tract, and once things, it's a very fine balance. Once it gets started, it's associated with the overgrowth of a lot of different bacterial species. It increases the risk of all of those negative effects, like pregnancy outcomes, post-surgical infections, acquisition of bacterial and viral STIs. And the current treatment, what they have to date, it consists of antibiotics, of which even if it helps, you know, I'll say 75% of women, within about, you know, 4 to 6 weeks, infections for about 40% of those women tend to recur. So they're looking for different dosage forms that one, can prevent recurrence, and two, nobody wants to take something again that you have to take every day, you know, daily administer, and something that won't promote, you know, antibacterial resistance here. So one of our ideas in this project that we recently started was, might we be able to develop different fiber architectures to deliver probiotics that can stabilize this dysbiosis in the microbial or in the female reproductive tract? And to date, there are some probiotic tablets and things on the market, but you have to administer them every day. They're not FDA approved. So could we develop something that could contribute to preventing and or helping prevent recurrent infections in women? So we took a similar approach here to build what is the end goal, is a sustained release platform, something that releases these live probiotic cells into the female reproductive tract. But we started easily, and we just started looking at hydrophilic polymers, so things like polyethylene oxide, polyvinyl alcohol, polyvinyl pyrrolidone. Why we need to look at those is because if you're spinning live cells, you can't spin them in a solvent, you're going to kill, as it is already, so you're going to kill live cells in a solvent. Moreover, when you electrospin these fibers, you're applying an electric field, which can shear and kill bacteria as well. So we started easily looked at just hydrophilic incorporation of these probiotics to create a core probiotic layer, with the vision that we would use similar fiber architectures to prolong the delivery of probiotics over time. And so here in some of our early work, I just wanted to show, like, here's our little fiber piece of paper in the petri dish. We have just a phase contrast microscopy image of, you can see our little lactobacillus entities within the fiber here. And then if we look at panels C through F, we just have different concentrations of either blank fibers in panel C. In D, E, and F, we have increased colony-forming units of bacteria with about 5 times 10 to the 8th colony-forming units of lactobacillus, permega fiber in panel F. And so pretty exciting, it's one of my favorite images where you can see these little bacteria in our hydrophilic fibers. This was a formulation challenge for us. A lot of probiotics, the main work out there has looked at probiotics in the area of food. So, you know, with breads and crusts and providing people nutrients in their cereal. So we looked at, we wanted to look at probiotic viability and stability. And so here we just looked at the amount of lactobacillus that was viable relative to our initial theoretical loading, whether they're freeze-dried or fresh bacteria you're trying to put in, whether you're submitting it in just plain water versus the media called MRS that the bacteria like, or if you're using an MRS glycerol mixture, which is, if you freeze these, they often come out of the freezer with glycerol added. And so what we found is that overall, you want to use fresh lactobacillus that have been, you know, subcultured before. And either water, you know, water or MRS work the best for electrospinning these in terms of getting the greatest viability of probiotics in our fibers. We also looked in the bottom. I just show an example of how we have started to evaluate the stability of these. That's really important, especially for places which may not have refrigerated conditions. And what we show is out to 90 days, if they're room temperature or in the refrigerator or frozen conditions, they maintain stability. But of course, at room temperature, we are currently working on formulations to mitigate this. As at room temperature, these fibers alone don't have a nutrient source for the bacteria to eat and stay alive. So we're currently developing, kind of doing a side project to look at prebiotic and probiotic formulations. Here I just wanted to show we tried these in vitro against, here's our free probiotic lactobacillus, which after about 4 and even 24 hours, it inhibits GB in co-culture in a soluble co-culture assay. We looked at fibers with different amounts, either an even dose or one order of magnitude less than GB, and also showed that they inhibit GB growth in co-culture, and perhaps it just takes a little longer to do so relative to free bacteria. And what we're doing with this now is we're incorporating different architecture fibers. So the end goal is, regardless of how long it takes, can we extend probiotic release to have these effects reach out, you know, a week, a month down the line? But these are just preliminary work highlighting that we're on the right track. Fibers that develop lactobacillus work, and we can develop more complex architectures to work on the temporal effects of how they work. Just recently received an R01 grant with Dr. Amanda Lewis at Washington University, and she's our expert in VV, both in humans and in an animal model. We gave her preliminarily some of our fibers to intravaginally administer in a murine model. She looked at these, and she has this model that female reproductive, it's actually very challenging to establish this bacterial model in mice. There are certain features that recapitulate what's going on in humans, such as expression of sialic acid, sialidase activity to cleave off sialic acids from areas of our reproductive tract. So she measures that as an innate expression. She's also developed a model to get GB. Actually, even getting GB to persist or show in a murine model is very challenging, and she has demonstrated that out to 8 days. So one of the very first experiments that we looked at is just using the PEO fibers. When we intervaginally administer them simultaneous to GB infection, we didn't see any deleterious effects with mucus sialic acid production, didn't see any increased level of GB infection in animals, and moreover, we retained the overall macro size properties of the female reproductive tract. I'll leave it at that for now. And then we also looked at just proof of concept, formulated some antibacterial, antibiotic PEO fibers just to show proof of concept that with an active agent, kind of a positive control, that the antibiotic worked in animals. And in fact, animals that were treated with an antibiotic fiber positive control had 500-fold lower titers in vaginal washes and were practically undetectable. Moreover, we have some indications from these very preliminary experiments that our fibers delivering antibiotic might help prevent ascending uterine infections as well. So that's really exciting. And now that we have received this grant, we look forward on building upon this to more strictly characterize our fibers and these controlled release fibers in subsequent years. But these these results suggest that fibers can safely reduce vaginal GB infections. So in summary for this latter project, which we've really just gotten started on in the last year or so, is we've demonstrated the first, or one of our goals is to demonstrate the first probiotic fiber feasibility against intravaginal BV infections. We are currently developing mesh leg and layered architectures to provide sustained release of these live bacterial cells against BV. We've assessed preliminary viability in soluble and tissue-based assays. We plan to do more things with heavy vaginal tissue mimicking the female reproductive tract before we do in vivo studies. We've looked preliminary at least at LINC and some other things for in vivo safety. And then one other thing we're hoping to do is to maybe develop new 3D printed probiotic inserts if our bioprinter can get, if we can get that working as some alternative delivery vehicle technologies. And with that, yeah, I just wanted to acknowledge, so I've had so many great collaborators during my time here, so Dr. Palmer on all of our microbicide work, Dr. Jamuth on our oral bacterial work, Dr. Fribos on a lot of tissue transport nanoparticle cancer work, Dr. Matova teaching us all of our HIV assays, and also Dr. Lewis, who I referenced in those last couple slides. Our current and previous funding sources are our lab website if you want to check it out. We can try to stay up to date with fund news. Here's just the group like over the years. And then here's these two guys, they come in stuffed animals, right? Asking if you have any questions, and they're hoping they get to stay together. I'm hoping that doesn't happen. So that's what I'm here for you guys today.